I'm Nicolette, and this is Catherine from B&W Tech. Thank you for joining us for our educational video series. Today we're discussing the Raman effect. Catherine, can you give us an overview?
The Raman effect occurs when you excite a molecule with light, and typically we use a laser because it's a very strong and monochromatic light. And we get some scattering of the light. Most of it comes back at the same energy, that's the Rayleigh scattering, but a very small amount of it is shifted in energy because of some absorption of the energy by the molecule, and that's called the Raman effect.
Okay, so how is that used in spectroscopy?
The amount by which the light is shifted is related to the chemical bonds and the atoms in the molecule. So we get a spectrum then, a Raman spectrum, wherein we have peaks related to the energy that is at these different positions, and that is a Raman spectrum. So those different positions can be used to help to identify what the different functional groups are and serve as an identification of the material. We can also relate the peak heights to the concentration of the materials in there. So we can get both qualitative and quantitative amount information from a Raman spectrum.
It sounds like Raman is similar to IR spectroscopy.
It is, as a matter of fact. They're complementary techniques. So we get an IR spectrum and we can get a Raman spectrum from material. And together, putting that information together, we can elucidate the structure very well. But there are differences in them. There are different phenomena that occur to give us Raman versus an infrared spectra. That's what makes them complementary, because the spectra aren't identical. So things that are strong in the Raman are things that are symmetric molecules, because we have a change in polarizability that comes from the Raman effect. Whereas with infrared, it's a measurement of the change in dipole moment. So polar molecules tend to have much stronger infrared spectra than a Raman spectra. So a polar solvent like water is a very strong IR spectrum, whereas it's quite weak in the Raman, which gives us an advantage with Raman in that we can use it in measuring aqueous systems, which is quite challenging when we're using IR spectroscopy.
Oh, that's interesting. So Raman is almost like a molecular fingerprint. Could you use it for identification?
That's right. That's exactly it. As I said, you have these distinct peaks that are related to what you've measured. So it's a molecular fingerprint. You can use that to identify because it's unique to every molecule. So we can use that to elucidate the structure, right, going back to the fundamentals. Or what we often do is we'll create a library of Raman spectra and compare what we've measured to what's in that library. Much like, you know, the police have a forensics database of fingerprints and they can identify based on a fingerprint they measure of a person back to that database. We do that with our Raman spectra. So we can measure a spectrum very quickly and get an identification by a rapid comparison to a library and see what a material is.
So would we be able to do that with these two little white pills? They look the same, but would we be able to use Raman to tell the differences?
Sure, we can measure the Raman spectra of those, and we can measure it non-destructively. So why don't you pick up that probe there? We're using a fiber optic coupled probe to our Raman, and it's a non-destructive measurement. You put the probe tip against the sample. The laser light will come to the sample and will collect the Raman scattered light and then get a spectrum from that. So go ahead and measure your first spectrum. Okay, we have the spectrum here, and that is your first material. And your first material, we're not using a library here, but it looks like that might be aspirin, your first one?
Correct.
Okay, and you have another material, so we want to see if that one's different from the first, right?
Right.
So let's go ahead and do the same thing. Put the probe up against the sample there and measure that spectrum.
Okay.
And here we see that we have now two spectra overlaid of each other, of your two materials. They're really quite distinctly different, one from the other. So we have the fingerprint of your aspirin tablet and of your Tylenol tablet. With the library, we could then have it automatically come up and identify what these materials are. So it is a great way to identify things quite rapidly.
Can you tell us a little bit about real-world applications?
What we've just done is very much a real-world application where we'd want to identify materials. Very often we look at this type of thing. Is this material something that we know, or is it maybe something that's counterfeit or unknown to us? In the pharmaceutical industry, they need to verify the identity of all their incoming raw materials. So they use an instrument that's even smaller than this one, our handheld instrument, to go out and measure the materials. And as you saw, you could measure directly in contact non-destructively, but you can also go through transparent packaging to make that measurement. So for material identification in the pharmaceutical industry, as well as in security, if you were carrying around some suspicious materials that were unknown, we could take a Raman spectra and identify them against the library. For forensics work in that same way, but in more research areas as well, we use Raman to look at medical diagnostics to determine whether or not a person has cancer based on the Raman spectra of the cells that could be cancerous or non-cancerous. We also use it in art and archaeology, where we take the measurement, the Raman spectra of pigments or of different compositions in cave paintings, for instance, and we can identify what the pigments are, and based on what pigments were used in which eras in history, get an idea of when that piece of work was created. So Raman has a lot of applications. Those are just a few of them, but it's really versatile and a great research tool.
Thank you so much, Catherine. I hope you learned as much as I did. For more information, you can visit us on the web at bwtech.com, or you can dial the number on your screen to speak to an application specialist. See you next time.